Hello and welcome to Eternal Durdles. I'm your host, Zach Clark, and with me as always, Phil Blackman and Nate Golia. Nate's back.
Hey, something must have happened if I'm back.
something must have happened, yes.
I really enjoy when something happens because that's when we know Nate's going to come back on.
Yes. Yeah, I'll come back. I'm like, oh yeah, like this would be great. I actually was going to reach out, then you actually said something first, which was nice. Because yeah. I love talking about bands.
Yeah, I mean, if there's one thing that legacy players love to do, it's discuss bands.
Oh, let me just caveat with this before we dive into the band announcement. What we were talking about in our chat thread before, where it should not feel good that bans happen. Like we should not the response to bans shouldn't be like, you know, it's Christmas morning and everybody's overjoyed. Like it's a bad thing when bans happen.
Well, I think you put it best. Is like if you put out a rap track and then took it down and everyone was super hype about you taking it down, you would feel terrible.
I don't think that's quite the same though, because there's so many new cards. Like, and you're like, you when something comes out, and you're like, oh, I would love to play this card or like these 10 cards, but this one card is going to just suck up all the air. It's a bummer. I do think this is in 2023. I think the theme of everything is just everything's getting a little bit worse, and this is not hitting the same as the previous bands. Everyone's still like, oh, whatever. Like this is everything still blows. So like that's kind of funny. But
my hot take is that bans are the Magic the Gathering equivalent of wokeness and cancel culture.
Look at it this way. You asked me to look up the previous bans.
Yes.
That's okay. May 18th, 2020, Lurrus the Dream Den and Zerda the Dawnwaker are banned. February 15th, 2021. Arkham's Astrolabe, Dreadhorde, and Oko were banned. I mean, that was like, oh, that's a real Christmas morning ban, right?
Yeah.
January 25th, Ragavan is banned. It's like, well, yeah, that sucked. And now this expressive iteration of White Plume Adventure, people are already saying like, all right, that's not going to fix anything, which I think is very interesting. I have opinions on that, but...
But we knew Ragavan wasn't going to fix anything. We just knew that they would slot Delvers back into their Delver deck.
Right.
I mean, it's a step in the right... again, I think these are all steps in the right direction. I don't think it's enough. I'm going to quote you here, nuke the format.
Yeah. Well, I will say, too, that it's funny that this happened yesterday or whatever day it was, because I moved. Like, I moved from Texas to South Carolina in December of last year. So basically, since, you know, Halloween, I haven't played much Magic at all because I was getting ready to move. Then I moved in. And then when I came back and checked in, the initiative deck, I'm like, well, that seems miserable to play against, which I know we'll talk about. Like, I don't want anything to do with that right now. And then this weekend, I went to Star City Con in Charlotte, because that's where I live now. And I was there to like sell some cards, trying to get rid of some things, lighten my load a little bit after moving them across the country like an idiot. But I will say I was like, oh man, I could kind of miss like playing and like getting into it. I'm going to start playing again. And I was like looking at some decks. And then like I woke up the next day and there was a ban list of Legacy. I'm like, oh, well, this does bring Legacy from I'm not even touching it to I will be willing to play it. And unfortunately, I think that means Phil is the only person here who really and will have a strong opinion on Initiative and White Plume Adventure.
Yeah, I mean, we all know that I only get to play every time there's a big event, so I never actually got to see Initiative hit the table because I didn't get matched up with it during Eternal Weekend.
Reading Phil's messages to our group thread is like reading Dante's Inferno for the past like 6 months because of that.
The text thread has a lot more heat to it than I'm seeing than it, the experiences in person, but it is. There is a lot of, I think that, you know, every single podcast is going to be talking about the bans in the next week and a half. And I think everybody is just going to be like, yep, these are great choices. Like you got to turn the format in some way. And I think we're going to be a little bit different. At least my take on it is a little bit different.
Yeah.
You know, we'll dive into it after we read it. But
Yeah. How do you want to handle this? Do you want me to stop and comment? Or do you want to read the whole thing?
No, let's read the whole thing. Nate, you want to take the helm here and read the announcement?
All right. March 6, 2023. Expressive Iteration is banned. White Plume Adventure is banned. While we made only changes to Legacy, we quickly discussed the state of formats below. Legacy, since the last update, the Legacy metagame has evolved such that the two major archetypes combined to make up a large portion of the field. Either the perennially popular Izzet Delver and the recently enabled Mono White Initiative. With their combined presence approaching 30% of the field in some circles, competitive play were choosing to ban one card from each deck to lower their respective win rates and metagame shares. Izzet Delver has been popular for quite some time in Legacy. Sorry, it's hard not to read it without laughing. And has picked up some notable recent additions, including Dragon's Rage Channel, Murktide Regen, and Expressive Iteration. While we acknowledge and agree with the many Legacy players who enjoy the play patterns of Izzet Delver and similar archetypes, our data indicates the need to take the win rate and popularity of the deck down a notch to allow for more metagame diversity and innovation. What a bunch of soft little weenies. I'm sorry. Oh, we have to say here, we think it's okay. You are valid if you like playing Izzet Delver, but you're also valid if you want to do anything else. Our choice to ban Expressive Iterations, the card quality and quantity it provides allows Izzet Delver to easily adapt to stay on top of any changes in the metagame. I think that is true, but also not the biggest problem. In addition to removing a generally strong card, our hope is that by removing Expressive Iteration, we reinforce Izzet Delver's historical strengths, efficient one-for-one exchanges, and weaknesses, lack of sources of card quantity, in a way that leaves the deck more vulnerable to metagame. That's all about Expressive Iteration. There's two paragraphs, okay. Since the release of Commander Legends Battle for Baldur's Gate, the initiative mechanic has had a large impact on Legacy and continues to rise in popularity. The current second most popular deck uses fast to ban out a power out an initiative creature, gaining an early advantage that's difficult to recover from. To reduce the consistency and speed of this gameplay pattern, we're choosing to ban the efficient 3-mana initiative creature White Plume Adventurer. According to our data, these two decks are holding each other in check, as well as stymieing misspelled additional metagame movement.
You saw that too.
Yeah. Therefore, we're choosing to impact both decks together. We'll continue to monitor if these changes are enough to open up the metagame and evaluate if further changes if needed going forward.
My biggest takeaway from this...
They're always monitoring. That's one thing that they do with every ban announcement, is they're always continuing to monitor.
The biggest takeaway I have from this is the first line of the next to last paragraph. Since the release of Commander Legends Battle for Baldur's Gate, the initiative mechanic has had a large impact on Legacy and continues to rise in popularity. I think that's it's wild that they're just like, yeah, well, this is the thing that's happening and it's become more popular. I think it hit like a thing and then it plateaued. Like you were either on that or you weren't. Like it wasn't like, woo, it's slowly creeping up. I think that's incorrect, but like,
if that's Ancient Tomb, that's the best thing to do. Was that what was going on?
I think. Or 8-cast. I think yeah, they're saying, mathematically speaking, it is this over 8-cast that is the best thing to do with an Ancient Tomb.
So the initiative did mechanically because of the fast mana, it meant that because you had 4x Cavern of Souls, like which came a week or two into the discovery, or like that initiative was playable as like a dominant deck, it gradually got to the point where 4x Cavern of Souls was just objectively correct, because they were like, if you can never interact with me, then the initiative will just win the game by itself and it doesn't matter. Yeah. And the cards were not designed to come down on turn 0 and turn 1. The 3 and 4 drops that are square statted that also have insane abilities that protect the initiative. So the argument that like the initiative is like the monarch where it incentivizes combat, the deck objectively does not do that at all. It makes it so that you can't interact with combat between Seasoned Engineer not giving pro creatures, White Plume Adventurer untapping itself, and then your entire team once you've gone through the entire dungeon, and then just playing 12 removal spells. It makes it so that if your deck's trying to go through combat, you can't do it. It's bigger and faster than you. The problem with initiative was because it was passive and you can't interact with it, if it came down on turn 0, the game was effectively over. Because that turn 1 play represented at least 15 damage before you could do anything. Yeah. Even in the fastest of draws, if you weren't a turn 1 combo deck that didn't care about the initiative being on the table, if you weren't Reanimator or Storm, if you were on the draw, even if you're the most popular deck, you're Blue-Red Delver, even on the draw, you go turn 1, Delver, whatever. If they stick their White Plume on that turn 1 and you don't have the force, or if they just wait until turn 2 like and start exchanging the initiative, they're faster. But if you don't have the force, then it takes an additional, like if you don't have that turn 1 creature on the play, the initiative advances 3 rooms before you have an opportunity to take it back. Because they hit it, they're in room 1, you have to play a creature, their turn 2 they advance, attack you, you are now effectively at 5 because they attack you for 5, attack you, the trap hits you. Then to take it, you have to attack, that taps your creature, and then you have to play another creature in order to block if you want to maintain the initiative.
Yeah,
like the play
pattern. Yeah, so and if that, they get through, then they dome you for five.
And they can just take the initiative back by casting another creature that's like casting a spell initiative.
Outside of combat.
I think the crazy thing about the initiative
was done at card parity.
Yeah.
Like, at no point did any of this initiative stuff ever cost, like playing a Lotus Petal, playing a Chrome Mox to go down a card. The initiative just recouped you the card immediately and then recouped you value along the way. You were never down a card in initiative. That was the crazy thing. It was all free.
Especially if you're playing with like Mox Diamond. You know, you're like,
here's the take on initiative real quick, and then I'm gonna pass it over to Nate, because I mean I've talked about initiative literally every cast since it's come out. I think initiative is an absolute fucking cancer in 1v1, and they should have just gotten rid of it entirely. Like, I get that, like, Legacy is the format where everybody gets to play all of the things that come out. This was this mechanic was not designed for 1v1. They were not designed to come down with fast mana in mind. And if they're going to leave the fast mana in the format as, like, you know, inherently part of the format's identity or whatever, which, you know, is the problem enabling this bigger problem, then just cut the cancer out. I don't think that it's doing anything then other than constricting what is playable in the format in a way that's not fun. And it's not like the play patterns are like new and different every game. You go down the same dungeon every time. The play patterns are the same every time. There's no difference in gameplay from game to game. Like, all this is to say, I think initiative is in 1v1 is just, it wasn't designed for it. It's just a mistake overall. Like, what I think is going to happen is White Plume will take people off of White Initiative for like the time being, and then like a month and a half from now, people are going to be like, "Huh, I wonder if I can make it work without White Plume." Then they're just going to play the red white version with all the four drops. It'll be maybe a turn slower, but it'll still be like a very dominant deck because Initiative is so powerful. And then people will be like, "Oh, this is also just really good." And then the deck will exist as like tier 1, tier 1/5, and with like all the four drops, and still just be absolutely insane.
Well, I mean, it's funny because one, I don't know how that initiative, I don't know how dungeons work because I have never had to figure it out, and I guess I'm gonna have to, so I can't. And two, it's also like, why this to me, this White Plume, this is the Lurrus, this is the Lurrus ban. Like, what? Whoops, well, we screwed that up real bad, you know. And they had to eventually. I'm gonna just double check because I don't think they changed. They did not change the. They did not change the rules on Companion for a while after.
It took until it started affecting Modern, like, which at the time was sort of their flagship format.
Yeah. What's wild is they had to ban the Companions even after adding the 3-mana tax.
Well, they don't. I actually disagree with that. They have not, where they have not unbanned them. Lurrus is legal in Vintage again.
I mean that, like, the 3-mana tax in like Modern and Pioneer. Like, it existed with the 3-mana tax, and then they still banned it.
Yes, oh, that's
like,
right.
It was powerful, even with it was. They banned it even after the tax. Like, they banned it in Legacy when you could still cast it straight out of your sideboard. There was never a time for Lurrus to cost 3 to go into your hand to play out of your, you know.
So, and Michael Adventure is like Lurrus. Like Lurrus in another important way, which is that it has another ability. That 3 for a 3/3, and it gives you the most broken thing to do, right? Because it always untaps on their upkeep, right?
Yeah.
Like, I'm reading this correctly.
The thing about the coinciding thing between Initiative and Companion are before the tax of being of 3-mana put it into your hand, there was no point where you could interact with it until it was on the stack.
Yeah.
And then similar, it's like, once the initiative hits the table, it is in the game. It is in the game until the game ends, and it will determine the game. You can't interact with it.
Is it in the command zone?
It is in the command, which is not a recognized zone in Legacy, except for Emblems, the Monarch, and Initiative.
Well, I feel like they're going to end up printing, like, everyone command zone is cleared or something. But that doesn't work with commanders, right? Because you can't just...
Legacy doesn't recognize... Legacy doesn't have the command zone as a zone.
Well, they keep putting stuff in it, though. Like... This is not the only thing that goes in there. There's, like you said, there's emblems, and as they get and uninteractable stuff, like they're always talking about how they want things to be interactable, and then these things are uninteractable. It's weird.
Well, beyond like value statements about how we feel about, you know, whether or not this is good or bad, where do we think the metagame's going from here?
Well, we should talk about the other band first, though.
Yeah.
Because, like...
I suppose, yes.
I think, because, like, to me, this thing was, I was like, oh, I guess that'll be nice. I won't have to think about this until, like you said, Phil, someone else figures it out. And I have seen already people like, well, the red-white one's still good, but you gotta want to play it, and it's not as pretty. Like, it's not as clean-looking as a deck, I don't think. So, like, I think there's some reasons that people will just not gravitate toward it the same way the mono-white one does. Okay, so they ban Express... I've been expressive iteration to take a whack at Delver. And I'm sorry, I don't think this card was what made Delver hard to play against. I think it's good.
What and do you think was the card that made Delver hard to play
against? Murktide Regent.
You think it's Murktide, okay.
I think it's Murktide Regent more than anything else, because fundamentally that's the broken, it shortens the game a ton. Like an 8-8 is like, the game's probably over in one swing. You know, it's effectively just going to end the game.
I don't disagree with you. I think that Murktide probably should have gotten banned too. Now, to that end, I bought the rest of my playset so I could actually use them, because I had been for like a year afraid that they were going to ban it. So I was like, well, we've got at least like 6, 7, 8 months before they do another ban announcement. If that, like, there might be another full year. So I was like, at least I can get a year out of these cards so I can get them. But yeah, when I played against Blue-Red Delver in at Eternal Weekend, that was the one card I was like, well, I guess I just lose.
Well, you know? To me, yeah. I guess my case against Expressive Iteration is that on turn two with an empty board, it's not good, right?
Yeah, because like, you can't net the land and cast the other spell. Like, you're going to just get one card off.
It's just a crappy ponder. It's just 2-mana ponder, right? And even not really, like, but like, so then something has to be exiled forever.
Ideally, you're playing this on turn three, putting a land into play and casting like a lightning bolt or something, you know?
Well, just putting a land into play,
you know, off of the exile, you know?
Like, it was the least scary turn two play, like, as opposed to like another threat and a wasteland, or kill their thing and wasteland you or something, right? Like, I'd much rather not see that than see this.
I think
they're not, if we, people didn't play it. I'm not saying people didn't play it that way.
I think now, if we don't consider its mana cost, I think that this card was as egregious as Treasure Cruise for its ability, because generally what's going to happen is you're going to draw three cards with Treasure Cruise, and one or two of those cards is going to be useless, right? You're going to be like, ah, it's a land, I don't need that. In this scenario, you're just taking that one card and throwing it on the bottom of your deck, which didn't matter in the first place, right?
So I disagree on one facet of that, which is they incentivize different kinds of builds. So Treasure Cruise, it didn't matter what you were doing if you were just churning through cards and putting them into your graveyard. It didn't matter if they were expensive or not. Sure. Expressive Iteration, until you're very late in the game, specifically wanted you to compress your curve so that you could always convert two cards.
Yeah, no, I don't disagree with you on that at all.
Well, I don't think like Delver playing Mishra's Bauble is, I don't think that's like bad in my opinion. And I remember I said that when Lurrus came out, I was like, well, what are they gonna do? Play Mishra's Bauble, no Delver decks? And it turned out I was wrong.
You
were wrong that it wasn't good.
Really
good.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, but like, did they need it? And my fundamental thing is like, I don't think that they needed it to be dominant. Now, the thing I will say about this EI is that the longer game decks probably benefit a lot more from it, because they're looking for that, the most efficient. They don't have a 2-mana spell that's that good late in the game when the card's average impact is a little higher in like your sort of 4-color amalgamation decks. And for that, I actually think, well, good, I don't have to deal with Expressive Iteration in that deck anymore either. But I also don't feel like I would have had to deal with Expressive Iteration in that deck either, because that deck is unplayable as long as Delver is good. Because why would you want to... I played against it yesterday with a deck that is absolute trash that I just made up, and I 2-0'd some deck with like an Uro in it. Like, I don't cares, man. Like, these games need to be over in 3 turns. You're trying to make it to a 4th turn? What are you doing?
I think that the signaling to me of WotC going after EI, I get like White Plume in the initiative, that's its own full mistake. That's just a companion level mistake.
Yeah.
That's entirely different. Like, I think they just didn't go far enough. So like, that ban is way easier to in my mind to explain. It's like, hey guys, we made a mistake, but we don't want to get rid of an entire mechanic because everybody, like, transgressive cards need a place to live, and therefore we're just going to get rid of the one that comes down on turn three because it's unique in that way. I mean, or turn three as the only three mana option,
yeah,
because it's unique in that way, and we'll leave all of the other ones so you can still have your the broken thing that we made.
You get to try
that we didn't
it, yeah,
design for you initially. Yeah. But the EI ban, I think, is to me, it signals that they don't conceptually understand anything about what they're trying to do with the format or what the format actually needs. Because EI, like, there was no deck in the format that you that was oppressed or eliminated from the format because of EI. Now, Delver as a shell might have been too busted and is moving things out of the format.
I disagree with that, but hold on.
That's a Day's Wasteland thing.
Yeah.
But like the idea that like there was nobody in the there was no deck that was like, well, I can't play this because EI exists.
These cards can't be played because EI exists.
Yeah. But the difference though is that EI was the best at what it does, right? In terms of like a cheap card advantage spell, it's the best at what it does. But that isn't unique to that card. The best at what it does, there's a bunch of things that do that. Grizzlebrand is the best at what it does. Uro is the best at what it does. Mm-hmm. The cards that are the best at what it does not inherently mean that it should be banned. But like, if you're going to target it only because it's in the best, the deck that's been the best for over a decade, then you're not actually solving any problems. That's not like, you're going after a card that isn't, by the metrics of the other cards that are the best at what they do, it's not a legacy power level worthy ban. And if anything, the deck that gets hit hardest by this is four color.
Yep, 100%.
I do like, agree with that. I think I just want to clarify my statement of what I don't disagree about yours is that expressive iteration didn't stop any other decks from existing. I disagree with that point only specifically because I haven't seen a non-blue red Delver deck, like a deck that must be blue and red and have Delvers, since the advent of expressive iteration.
So that's why it's the best at what it does. And so the cards that also try to do similar things, you are handicapping yourself by not playing the best version. If you play a reanimator deck that isn't focused on trying to get Grizzlebrand out on turn one, you are voluntarily handicapping potentially the turn one win, right? Like, it's the same way where it's like, yes, predict is not as good as EI. If like, you should just be maxing out on EI before you play any of the other versions. For in that respect, I think it's reasonable to get rid of a card like EI, but that's not why they got rid of it.
No.
If they got rid of EI,
they say they got rid of it for sure.
It's the same thing that's like, if the best card at one for Delver is DRC, right? Until DRC is gone, you're never not starting at four DRC.
Yeah.
And so it's the best at what it does. And as long as there's an objectively best version of the role that a card is playing, there's no reason to look elsewhere. And that stifles diversity. You know, when Deathrite Shaman was around, nobody started anywhere else until four Deathrite Shaman. So it's like, now there's the talk of like, okay, are we going to play Predict? Are we going to play Mercurial Spell Dancer? Are we adding a third color to play something entirely? Are we moving up the curve a little bit to like, you know, go back to Uro or play Minskin Boo out of the sideboard? Like, now there's interesting choices to be made, you know? It's because there isn't necessarily the best version of one of a card advantage thing. So now there's a choice to be made for a given metagame. In that regard, it's a healthy ban. I'm not like, I think that it's okay. I think it's okay to ban EI, but I think the reason that they banned EI is so far off from why it was a reasonable ban to begin with. Like, I think that like how they viewed it was wrong.
I want to also, yeah, I agree. Well, it's interesting because I wonder if there is a reason to play something like Predict over Expressive Iteration, but maybe that's just not possible. I think all those things are impossible because Delver is a deck and anything you're trying to set up like over time, not like on the first two turns, like a combo deck you're trying to set up, but like the most popular combo deck is turn one Dark Ritual Doomsday or turn one Dark Ritual Entomb Exhume. Like there's no, you're not setting something up over time, like, you know, in other ways. Zach, you said there's no other Delver deck that doesn't play blue and red, but they're the bug decks have always been a aberration in that way, you know? And there's
I'm not saying like, ooh, we need to have like bug Delver and rug Delver. Like, you know, I don't think that like a diversity of Delver decks is what makes the format like, and this goes against what I have said in the past. I don't think a diversity of like different color Delver decks makes the format like its best. But I think that there should, that having that there, it at least gives people the illusion of choice, you know? Well,
they could just give people the reality of choice.
Yeah.
You know, that is also a thing that could happen. Because, like, you know, Death Shadow, like, I missed the whole snuff out thing that was going on. Like that was happening, and that doesn't... I mean, I guess you were just playing red in that because of Expressive Iteration, right? Is that the deal? You would play...
Bolt was one of those things where, like, you could win if you had, like, two Death Shadows out and you bolted yourself.
The whole adaptation of Snuff Out was, it wasn't even the addition of black cards. They just wanted a free spell to be able to, like, kill the initiative without losing tempo because the games were so fast.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
They would just play an Underground Sea plus Snuff Outs so that they could exchange for free. It was just another compression of the format.
Yeah.
Snuff Out just happens to be a free spell.
Snuff Out is actually very, very good in Death Shadow, but you don't normally play three of them in the deck. You play like one or two, but it got to a point where it was like, let's kill the thing on the first turn because we have to.
I also like, I mean, there's a lot of good writing out there that some of it's old, but it's still interesting if you're interested in it to read about the development of Threshold as a tempo strategy. And how it started out as just blue and green, and then it was kind of like, well, we should just put Bolt in this, right? But yeah. There was also like a white version that was more controlling. I mean, that was when the mechanic was really Threshold.
It was like tempo. Mystic Enforcer deck.
Well, the thing I'm saying is that, like, the reason people are going to always play blue and red is because what's Delver? It's a Bolt every turn. Well, you know, this is a Bolt, a Bolt. Like, so why am I going to play?
Come, I'm play come it. Out with some sort of a ram through for.
Why am I playing? Why am I going to play Assassin's Trophy when I can just play Bolt? And like, because sometimes like that will do everything I need that to do.
Well, having the reach is
there's no reason
obviously why people play red.
And the bug Delver decks were able to work because of Deathrite Shaman going around combat when things sold out. But that's why you're never going to see another. And also, you don't need to go into another color because Murktide Regent just means that if you are looking for a big body to finish things off, it's right there. You don't even, you know, if they printed a blue Bolt, you wouldn't need to play red at all either. Like, so
blue Bolt coming in commander.
Yeah, right. But that's to me, that's more than anything. More than I even Dragon's Rage Channeler. Like, I still think like it still means that you have to start on a non-basic land. You know, other decks can still play it if they were to able to exist, if there's ever to be another aggressive archetype, but there just cannot be as long as there is Delver and Murktide Regent to just say like, oh, not only can you play all the best blue card draw spells and counter spells, but you can also just get the best threats. And that's a problem. That's going to be the biggest problem. It's always the biggest problem.
Yeah.
Until they decide to change it, I don't think anything's going to change. And I don't think that this makes Delver easier to beat. I truly do not. And I don't, it's kind of funny. Now that they don't have white, now that there's no white from Adventure, what is the next thing that's going to beat this deck?
I think this example, everybody that has been excited about the ban and it's like, oh man, I can't wait to try a new format. The format will be exactly the same. Like, maybe initiative will fall off a little bit, but like,
well, it'll just be red. It'll just be Blood Moon again. Like, they'll just go switch over to the red version of that deck, right?
I just mean that, like, you're the Ancient Tomb out a thing that effectively wins the game before you get, like, any amount of agency in the game whatsoever, or Delver, like, those things are still just going to be at the top of the format. Like, the format isn't going to change. This announcement is the same as every other previous announcement where no shell was impacted.
Yeah.
Like, the shells of the things that remain dominant, neither were impacted. This is just another, this is another three mana artifact dying for the sins of Mish's Workshop.
So, Phil, yeah. I feel like what you're saying, and correct me if I'm wrong here, is that Murktide Regent Expressive Iteration aren't the problem. So what is?
No, Murktide Regent's the problem. I'm going to go that far. Please, go ahead, Phil.
I'm throwing you a layup here. I'm bumping it for you.
Yeah. I mean, the problem's always going to be Day's Wasteland threat, and then fast mana, like stuff that's enabling the broken stuff. But if the stuff that is being enabled by it is also just like, if like the difference between something like just a basic threat that doesn't do anything else versus something that has snowballing advantage, like the snowballing advantage is just it pressures that stuff so much steeper than the, like, if you're playing, if you go like your Blood Moon or whatever, like, okay, there are ways that I can play around that by if I want to go into that meta and try and beat it, I'll play more basics. And if I naturally have basics, then your turn one sucks. I have some amount of decision making that I can do where it's like, okay, your turn one gives you an uninteractable mechanic that wins the game passively by itself. Like, okay, I guess there's nothing I can do. And then similarly, Delver obviously a little bit less so, but like if you play a turn one threat that has insane snowballing advantage as like by doing literally anything, by just playing the game, it will give me snowballing advantage on the back of the shell that compels you to act. Yeah, you're gonna get fucked. And like that thing is just going, like that thing will fly under the radar. Like DR, like if you actually wanted to like check Delver's win percentage, I think, and you weren't willing to go after Days or Wasteland, you gotta check DRC, in my opinion.
Well, like, hold on a second. The cards. I would say, I think that's, the only reason I think that's wrong is that I think that we have not seen that card have any success outside of being paired with Murktide Regent. And that's what I'm saying. The Del flyer that is huge, like, come on, man. I played DRC in some decks and they were like okay, and I tried exalting them with that Jund hierarch thing, right?
Like noble hierarch.
I had like some small, you know, graveyard, but there's nothing like making an 8/8
and daring them to beat it. I think they're two different things. I am not defending that a 2-mana 8/8 is a reasonable thing to have in the format. Like I'm not defending that's objectively not above curve. It's obviously above curve. Like it's too powerful, like given the speed at which the format can move. But I think of all the cards that are currently in Delver, if you wanted to actually check Delver's win percentage, you'd have to go after DRC. That's the card that is doing the most work but flying under the radar. For it, like the thing that feels like it's killing you is the Murktide that was enabled by the DRC or the Expressive iteration that is like got me so deep into my deck to find all this stuff anyway because of DRC. Like the DRC is the fulcrum point in the deck, I think, outside of the shell. Like that's the card that if you actually wanted to stymie it, you'd go after that card.
I'd be interested in seeing that. I wonder what would happen in that case because they have not, well, there's been Treasure Cruise. I think that DRC doesn't need, like, I don't think Murktide Regent needs DRC for it to be. I just think that DRC soups it up. I think that this card would just be played. They put something else in that spot. I don't know what it would be, but I don't know what's out because I want to get to that in a second.
The answer is going to be Charter Course.
I'm talking about without Dragon's Rage Chandler.
Oh.
Whereas I think Dragon's Rage Chandler, I think Delirium is an interesting, like, the Jund Delirium deck that I was talking about, like, I had pretty good success with it because it's a cool engine. That was like doing stuff that was, you know, sort of something, you know, it was pretty powerful. And this was like a nice payoff for it. Like, I mean, Tarmogoyf is fundamentally a Delirium card, right? Yeah. So you've got that and Tarmogoyf and you know, then you've got the Traversial and Wall. Then you've got like, you know, a good reason to play for Mishra's Baubles and all that stuff. And even, but nothing is like an 8/8. Even the Tarmogoyf with everything is not going to be an 8/9 unless you really work on it. The thing I want to talk about with regards to Delver is that I don't think there's any way, like Expressive Iteration, yeah, whatever, right? The threats are what's making it so hard because you don't have enough time, you know? Long has it been since you could just soak up a couple hits and then go from there, because like when you get something as big and as evasive as a Murktide Regent, then
how many Surveil dumps, let's say you have a DRC on the table, right?
Uh-huh.
How many spells do you cast where you surveil a card you don't want for it to be considered as powerful as drawing a card?
Oh, I don't know.
If you let's say you have a DRC and they kill it, but you have surveilled two cards you didn't want to the yard, is that equivalent to drawing a card?
Over the course of three draws, I think that, you know, assuming you're getting a card at the beginning of each turn, Surveil 2 is the equivalent to me of drawing a card as far as value is concerned.
It's two draw steps that you didn't want those cards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thinking about that in a vacuum of I got to skip my draw step that I didn't want for free is bonkers.
Yeah.
It is so bonkers. But like, I'm saying that like that. If they wanted to actually hinder Delver in like the deck itself in any meaningful way, going after EI is them not fully understanding where the format actually sits, because they just pushed four color and having to refigure themselves out. Delver will just adopt the next best card advantage spell, whatever that is, or whatever new thing comes along that's printed. But DRC in Legacy, at least, exists in one deck. If they actually wanted to hit one deck, they would have gone after the card that's in one deck.
You guys talked about Mercurial Spell Dancer, right?
We did. We did a whole episode.
I didn't get a chance to listen to it. I saw that you did it. I remember people.
I mean, if they got rid of Dragon Rage Chamber, I would assume that would be the exact card that would get slotted directly.
Well, it's two mana. It's two mana. I don't know what they would. Yeah. I don't know what's available at one. Maybe that thing that draws, discard your hand and draw four cards. But like, I was just thinking about. I was like, I told you guys, like, this card. I don't think this card is good. I think it, like, it's gonna feel good, you know, because like, yeah, anytime you get something to work, but like, you can get anything to work in this deck because of how it's constructed before you even start putting those cards in.
I will say this name. I think it's less good now because initiative not being a thing, that unblockable thing is not as big a deal.
Right. And also, I guess you're not going to copy Expressive Iteration, which I guess people are doing.
Also true. Yeah.
I do want to say
in two ways.
The thing that I was like, okay, that card. And you know what? Here's the thing, I was right, because you guys remember, it wasn't that long ago. Remember Ledger Shredder? Remember that was going to be that was going to be a Delver staple for years, and then just gone. Just who needs it? What am I playing this for? You know, and like, there's always cards like that people try out because like they pay off your you know, they pay off what the deck is already doing well, right?
Yeah.
And so at some point they have to actually and I think Expressive Iteration did as well, because a turn three or plus EI was effectively just a draw two for two, and you also like you never have mana problems when nothing in your deck costs more than two, like. It's not like you're going to EI into 3-4 drops. Like, you can't, like, in some other deck, you might by accident, you know? Or even 2-4 drops that you want, and you have to pick one to go into your hand, and the other one has to be buried. Like, that's why I think, like, that's why I was saying, well, this wasn't the right thing. And it's why I'm always focusing on, like, the curve is just too low. Like, you can't play, you need fast mana to play up a curve at all. And, you know, Murktide Regent is fast mana by just putting the mana in your graveyard, and nothing is like that. Dragon's Rage Channeler is a really good card that I think I still don't know how. I still can't say that it's just a turn 1/3/3. Like, I don't know, that happens.
It's just a turn 1/3/3 flyer that fixes your draws. Yeah, that's it. That's all it is.
But it's not even that for a while. It's not even that for a while. It's like a 1/1, so it's like not even. And it, like, I don't know. I think that like it softens you up, just like Delver. Like, Delver is only a turn 1/3/2.
Right.
Like,
I mean, they just banned turn 1/3/3 in this banning. So I mean,
if my preordains, also chunked you for three every turn,
but they don't.
That's crazy. They don't. That's totally. Of course, it shouldn't.
As long as I'm just reading this card again because I'm just like. I'm reading it and I'm like, I mean, it's powerful, but like, it's like you're saying about, yeah, it's not just because it is the best, the most powerful thing.
I think that if they wanted to go after, like, this announcement, if they wanted to solve the problem that EI was doing of being the best thing that of what it does, they needed to present, we are banning EI so that the other options for card advantage can be played in the format, because EI was keeping those cards out of the format. And now there's actual reasonable choice to be made. You know, it's like, when in a long time ago, when Phyrexian Mana first came out and you could play Dismember in your standard decks, yeah. There was no reason to do anything else because Dismember was just the best version of a removal spell. So you didn't have to think about what removal spell to play. There was no consideration for a choice. That's what EI did. But the thing is, they didn't ban it because of that reason. They banned it because they were like, we need to take Delver down a notch. And that means that they don't, it's the same thing that they've done every single ban for a decade. They just don't get it.
Well, they did. The last two were Ragavan, which was too powerful, and Dreadhorde Arcanist. Like, that was also.
I mean, they were all in service of blue red Delver is too powerful though.
Right, but they did go after threats and not. They didn't miss the mark as badly.
I think what I would have liked to have seen here with this announcement is that is instead of saying like, here are the three cards we were looking at, and we chose this one, and okay. Moving on.
Well, that's what they did.
What I would have liked to have seen is, we chose Expressive Iteration. Here's why. Also, Dragon's Rage Channeler and Murktide are on notice.
I guess what I'm saying
is, I think the stuff unnoticed doesn't matter. Like they said that
it is.
They,
I mean, I would not have bought Murktide if they said Murktide was on notice.
They said Murktide and Expressive were on notice after Raghavan, and then it took them a year to
get rid of EI.
And then they got rid of EI for the wrong reasons.
I can shoulder $40 of Murktide to lose if in a year they decide that they don't want that in the format anymore.
Which is why
I went for the buy.
What else would pay off a bunch of surveils that is somewhat playable? Well, there's a bunch of those like big blue flyers at this point, right? Isn't there something that's like
Sailor's Bane, but that doesn't fly.
Cryptic Serpent.
For each card you
find. All of those cards that like are Murktide adjacent in blue don't have evasion.
Right, and I guess what I'm saying is like, I could still see Murktide Regent being in the Delver deck if DRC was banned. But I don't think that DRC would feel as oppressive if it wasn't powering up something way down the line. Because more than anything, that's the reason you got to get rid of it. Because you're like, I got to keep Murktide Regent off the table. Because if a Murktide Regent hits the table, I cannot win. Because it will kill me in a turn.
So I think that like the rationale that I have against DRC over Murktide. Now, granted, like I wouldn't lose sleep if either of them got hit.
Yeah.
But the rationale is that Murktide is good in against the decks that like you like to play that like go beyond like the thing is like you would board out Murktides in fast matchups, right? Like it is still too slow against combo, but DRC is just good against everything. Like across the board, if your turn one is DRC, that is excellent in the blind. That is excellent against everything.
Yeah, I mean between like damage against decks that you just want to kill them fast, and then damage like selection against other decks that you want selection against, everyone. You want to be dealing clock, damage, and you want card selection, obviously.
Being a clock and selection as your turn one in the blind is the thing that you want to do every single time. Whereas like if you're playing against any form of combo, like your 8-8 flyer in the air on turn, even if you cast it on turn three, like it's still going to be too slow.
I think that unfortunately there's no way to know. I've played it a lot. Like I played that deck a lot before I moved with Dragon's Rage Chandler and stuff. And I was just like, I'm a lot of times I'm just keeping the card on top. I'm like, oh, I want that card, you know. So like it really sang with something like Sylvan Library, you know, where you could just be like, aha, I'm gonna like draw this, mill that, and then that's, you know, I'm kind of churning through. But that's what I deserve for playing Jund. I deserve the chance to actually get something to do something. the plan is so much around these decks, it's just like if the game isn't over by turn four because they were a combo deck that I killed or something, then all I have to do is get a Murktide into play and protect it. And yeah, I don't think that's more linear than like I'm starting with this card and let's see where the game goes. I think it's a little bit more enjoyable on both ends of the match, because that was the problem. That circles back to what you were talking about with the initiative, which is like there's nothing interesting about the initiative other than the fact that you win because it's so easy. But it's like, oh, I got this thing that I put these new rules that only apply to me into the game. Like that's Calvin Ball. It's not fun. No,
Calvin Ball is a great game if you're Calvin.
I do agree with the idea that like you should the idea of Murktide Regent, it is a color pie break in a way of like you get to the actual biggest creature in Legacy is in blue and not in green. Like that is a reasonable take.
And I think that what it does is it kind of cheapens the whole thing, because once that at some point there's an understanding, like, well, this is the deal. If this card comes into play, the other player loses, you know? And so they don't even have, they can let you cast whatever you want as long as it doesn't prevent them from sticking and attacking with a Murktide. And I don't think that's interesting. It's one of those things where you're like, of course they're gonna let my stupid whatever else resolve because they know it doesn't matter because this 8-8 is gonna just carry them through the rest of the day. And one other thing about EI just specifically that was interesting was that like I was like, oh, nothing felt better than blowing one of them up with a Pyroblast. You know? It's like you're trading up in mana, they've probably tapped out because it's turn two or turn three and they're doing it before. Oh god, and they can't daze your Pyroblast back because it's only one mana and you've got two lands in play. nothing felt better than that, except for when it was just like next turn they just played, they just exiled it and made a 6/6 in the air.
Yeah.
And you didn't have Pyroblast for that. And then you're like, oh, I guess I gotta find another Pyroblast because I can't abrupt decay this or whatever. Or I mean, then, you know, if I try to do anything else, I'm, you know, gonna get just blown out by one of these other free spells, like, yeah, or they're just gonna make another.
It is the case that like every new card that enters their deck, there's like the additional line of text that the card doesn't need in order to be powerful. Like it's a flying lady, extra... then it has the text to grow.
DRC has other ones.
Like DRC is a 1/1 that fixes your draw every time you like. Anytime you do anything, it just fixes your draw, and then also happens to be better than Delver. Like it's like it doesn't need the additional text.
Yeah. I mean, they're tailor-made for each other, DRC and Murktide Regent. So I still think one of them is more. I would rather play against a turn one card because I think that there's still uncertainty at that point, and there's still it's more interactable. Whereas the other one is just like, no, this is the whole point now. the whole point is just to chunk you to death with this.
The other thing that's interesting too about Murktide is the only cards that can trade with it without like below mana parity are Swords to Plowshares and a Pyroblast effect.
Yeah,
that's it.
Those are both counterable.
I guess Snuff Out, but like Snuff Out has also a larger cost. Yeah, but also
that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying because like a Murktide. Murktide will kill, like, let's say you're on the other end of it, right? You're playing some sort of mid-range deck. Murktide will block any creature. It will kill any planeswalker that you put into play for free, right? But yeah, I'll let you resolve that planeswalker. Unless you're going to get rid of this Murktide, which I will stop you from doing some way, like, I'll just attack that and kill it next turn. And then next turn, you're just dead.
This is making me think that I'm hearing your stake against Murktide as Murktide is preventing any of these cards that you would like to play or any other archetypes that you would like to play are just kind of the way that like I felt when I would play against Initiative, where I was like, okay, if I want to play a creatureless or close to creatureless deck in an Initiative format, I am soft. That type of shell is soft banned. You just can't do it.
Mm-hmm.
And that like similar that you have the feeling that decks that you've played feel like they are soft banned because of Murktide Regent. And by soft band, I mean like they're not competitively viable because you know that you're going to run into this a Murktide in a competitive event.
Or you can beat you if you figure out a way to beat that, you're going to lose any of the other edges you might have, right?
I wonder if that's where, I mean, because that's similar in what I was talking about for EI. I feel like that's similar where it's like because this card exists, these other cards are no longer viable. Like EI exists, so the other card advantage spells aren't viable. And then, that argument, when extended to Grizzlebrand, also extends to stuff like Uro. It extends to like all the cards at the top of the format. It's just the best version of a thing with no reasonable counterpart to be considerable. So there's no real choice to be made aside from those things because they all do everything.
Well, think about Murktide Regent versus Uro, because this is a pretty funny point, an interesting point, right? So let's say they cast the Uro and it's gonna go to the graveyard, right? Like they don't have a Caracas, they don't have any, they probably don't have a Stifle. I actually thought I was gonna get Murktide trigger Stifled, or I'm sorry, a Uro trigger that was gonna be self-stifled, and that would be cool, but they didn't do it. Let's say you know it's gonna go to the graveyard. That's fine because I could make up that 3 life that they just gained. I'm just gonna do that to them. 2x that to them on the crackback here. And they've spent 3 mana tapped out and spent their whole turn doing that. Then when they want to bring out the graveyard and they use all their resources to tap out again, then I can force it. I mean, that's brutal. They're just like, okay, use all your mana again. Okay, and then, okay, I'm going to hit you for another 7 or 8 or whatever it is. And then it's just sitting there. Like, are they going to do it again? Like, now they got a swords your Murktide. Okay, I've got another Murktide. Because I just use all these cards. I got another Murktide, or a bolt you. Like that's what makes it so egregious, I think, because the deck is just set up like that is way the creature is way too big for the shell. It's like that's why I mean even no other implementation has had it for less either. Like, there's been like Stifle, Dreadnought, and stuff, but that's 2-for-1. Like, it's like a 2-for-1. There's like Tarmogoyf, but that was a ground creature that made you play into one other color.
Not to mention, it was like generally a 4-5. Like, that's why we're not playing Rug Delver anymore. Like, green creatures when we can play a giant blue creature?
Question. I gotta write down Delver with Grizzlebrand.
Like that. question for you then. This is always the crux of a ban episode. Do you agree or disagree with the choices that they made in the ban announcement? And if you were in control of the ban announcement, what would you have done in their place, if anything at all?
Well, same answer to that as always. You ban every card till True Name Nemesis is too good, and then you ban True Name. And then you have a workable format. I mean, it's up to probably like 30 cards now. But I actually don't think this is an interesting thing because, like, yeah, you had to get this. You had to do something about this initiative deck because it just introduces another rule set. No one's going to want to play against. No one wants to play against it. I didn't. Like, I heard people don't want to play against it. And like that will drive players away. So
the best kind of Magic are the ones where you cast a spell and then it introduces 6 game pieces.
Yeah, right. Exactly. So, I mean, that was the same problem with it's the companion problem, right? And then, of course, like, the double thing was just like, well, I mean, I guess it's kind of cool because, I mean, I'm glad that the 4-color decks are going to have to figure something else out because I find them irritating to see because they're just such an abomination. Just like, yep, like, this was just every good card versus
the... I was going to say, for the fact that you were earlier, like, kind of defending that as a fallout of this ban is funny to me because it's like you get to a point where like it doesn't even matter what your mana base is. You just like throw a bunch of duels and fetches into a deck and you're like, I can play whatever I want.
Four color is the result of fetch lands existing, but I also think that they printed the most powerful spells that they print also incentivize, like, they reward you for having egregious mana bases, you know, like Prismatic Ending rewards you for having all of the colors available to you at all times. Like, that's I think that, like, from design, if you know that fetch lands exist, you shouldn't be incentivizing that stuff.
Well, they banned Arkham's Astrolabe. Like, that was because people were like, we do not want to play against every card all the time.
Look, my stance on why they banned Arkham's the exact same reason why they banned White Plume Adventure, and that's because they don't want you playing with basic lands. And they don't want Legacy to be a format that is easily accessible for the mass populace based on not having to buy dual lands. They will be banning something from Death Shadow soon.
Oh yeah, so you're gonna be because of the shock lands. Yeah. But I don't know. I think that they also I think they also see that as it's funny they wouldn't say it. I don't think they know it, or I don't think they did it on purpose either. It is weird. It's just like I'd like to feel like, I guess it's one of these things where it's like as you're taking time off and coming back and looking around at things, it's like, yeah, I mean, it's like kind of cool to see something that looks like, you know, that sort of stirs up like what made you interested in this game in the first place, you know. Like, initiative is like a monkey's paw version of that. It's like, oh yeah, it was cool to see all these like wonky cards together, but they only are able to exist because the game itself becomes unrecognizable, you know?
Yeah.
Once it happens. And then, you know, you want to see, like, I was going through my cards, I was looking around and just looking around at things at the con, and I was like, oh yeah, like, it's gonna be like tribal decks. That was kind of cool. Like, so we have to play Merfolk, like, to do something, to like have a blue aggressive deck or something like that. Or like even Miracles, like it was like a deck that like really had to like put together, and like what pushed Miracles over the top? A threat. It was Monastery Mentor. Once that happened, it could no longer be abided, which I think is interesting. You know, like it was, I didn't love playing against it, but I was like, at least it was like something, like there was an alternative to it, you know, because it was Stoneblade. But I do find it interesting how many Cephalid decks there are out there. I think that's kind of fun.
It'll be interesting. I mean, part of the Cephalid picking up was similar to why 8-cast moved towards the Painter package, was because initiative was such a beating that you wanted to play creatures to be able to take the initiative, but then having an auto I win button meant that you didn't have to care about whether if they were able to run through the dungeon, because you could just kill them on the spot. So having a creature-centric combo deck that could kill before turn three was incentivized. It compelled the format to be faster, and then it just rewarded you additionally for playing creatures if you didn't just have the free combo to begin with, because they were playing shit like Archon of Emyria that punished stack-based combo as opposed to creature combo.
Yeah, weren't they also playing something called like Empty Shrine Kanushi?
That was post-board, which effectively just gave you protection from white so that you could steal the initiative back.
Yeah.
But turns out that initiative players solved that real quick by just playing some number of Walking Ballista, and it's just like, all right, yeah, whatever. No, like, kill that. Shit sucks. Like, that was really stupid.
But yeah, it's like, boy, I wish there was a deck that played something cool like Empty Shrine Kanushi, like the Monkey's Paw Curls, and you get the initiative deck. Well, we're going to change the rules of the game for that to happen. Oh, okay.
Yeah, I remember, I forget who... I've heard many a time that there's like the argument that like games need to end, and I'm like, the format is always forever the fastest it's ever been. Like, it's just always the fastest it's ever been. I think it's okay for games to reasonably go past turn four some percentage of the time.
Do you think this is a reaction to the banning of Sensei's Dividing Top, where they're just like, let's make the format even faster?
I think there's something to be said about they got rid of the card advantage spell that isn't a threat, right? It can find and produce threats, but it's not the threat of itself, right? Like, yes, you get buried under cards and then can't, and then you just lose because you're they have six cards and you don't have any. Like, yes, that is similar, but it doesn't necessarily, like, there are decks that, like, you know, if you fucking, I've lost the Cavern of Souls enough times to know that I can have a full grip and it can be totally irrelevant, you know? Yeah. Like, there are ways to play around it where it's like, yeah, if you're going to get chunked for half your life total every combat, like, all right, maybe it doesn't matter what I do, because I have to pay for spells, which requires time. And if time is the thing that is not allotted to me in any reasonable way, then there isn't actually much agency to be had. Considering that the London Mulligan also helps those decks out even further, you know?
Yeah.
Like, well, it would be interesting to see what initiative would look like in a not London Mulligan format. If we were still in the Vancouver Mulligan, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's probably a good place to like stop though, for this cast, because we're coming up on an hour. General consensus is that this ban was fine, but like they could do more.
This was the most they could do. There's a material component here. This is the most they can do, and that's not really great.
Right, I think that there is a continuation of like the format. Well, like the format is inherently cancerous, and they're just like, look. We have access to the cure, but we just don't want to actually invest in it.
Right.
We're just gonna like we will continue to keep it, so that it can breathe, but like it will just forever be sick with the inherent sicknesses that, you know, we need those sicknesses to exist somewhere. So
yeah.
Like
exactly. Yeah.
I think that's like the. I wish that was something that they could say, that way we could always refer to it, because otherwise it's assumed, but it can be assumed that they maybe aren't aware. Like, we know that they're aware that there's a lot of like egregious things in the format, like all of the design mistakes exist in the format, but the ones that don't require, that don't ask anything of you, that you just get to have and are broken, you know, it's like those are the ones where I wish they would just come out and be like, we understand that there is a lot of, like, this is a list of cards that we agree are, that they should not exist. They are mistakes, and that we should not have printed them. And that, like, at any point, it would be reasonable for us to take action against them. But we won't, because they need, we want them to exist.
And we did it
somewhere.
Well, we did it. You know? We did it. So now we
did it. We did it. And we want to exist. And it's like, same thing that we have a ban list. there's also a transgressive cards list. And I just want to know what those cards are. That way we don't have to keep going and
but when
like,
we eventually like, get Aaron Forsythe onto the cast, we'll know that. Right. We'll know that. I hear he's supposed to be coming on soon.
Dude, I can't wait for Aaron to come on. We're very excited. The thing that every single time there's a ban list, the first thing that comes to my mind is the meme of what's his face in the hot dog outfit after crashing the hot dog car into the store, and he's going, "We're trying to find who did this.
Trying to figure out who
we
did
just don't
this.
Know. We don't know who's responsible for these problems. We just don't know." And it's like, yeah. just lay it out for us, please.
Yeah. All right. Well, with that said, I think this is again this is a good spot to cut it off. Nate, thank you so much for coming on this week. If you
it's good to be back.
If yeah, dude, it's so good to have you. If you dug the fact that we brought Nate back on, like and subscribe. You ought to. Yeah, at least like, comment, all that stuff. I'll be giving away cards. As always, here we go. I'll pick one out right now. We're doing 2000. We're doing 2015 and 2014. We'll be giving
what
out.
What are those?
So these are from the event advent calendar. And so what we do is anybody who comments, we do a drawing and we give those cards out, send them out to people. So if you comment on the this episode on YouTube, you're in the drawing. And so
Nate, we all got to start commenting. You and I should start commenting.
I don't even know what this product is.
You were one away from winning because we normally give one out to our Patreon supporters, and Nate is a Patreon supporter.
That's right.
Nate almost won a card last week. He was one die roll away.
Oh, well, what are you going
to
do?
So close.
All right.
Anyhow, that's it for us this week. Nate, again, thanks for coming on, and we will see everybody next week.
Hey, thank you for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Check out this other video, and if you can, please support us on patreon.com.